always had those big blue, her eyes were always so blue with that fair, fair complexion. And when Vicky was small, her hair was blonde. And I would dress her in white a lot. And her eyes, it was like you could just see through them, you know. Vicky was a sweet baby. Coming up, when she was little, you know, I dressed her every day in an outfit. You know, the fancy little dresses, the little white shoes. And she stayed like that all day long. She never got dirty. I took her everywhere. Never got out of the stroller. Never threw fits. She was just a joy as a baby, you know. She was so pretty. Yeah, she was a happy baby. Vicky was always happy, always laughing, loved outside, you know, and everything. But she was just, I don't know, it was just so pleasant. And I realize that now. Sometimes I'll be around people that have little kids and they screaming and hollering. She never did that. I could have come in here today with Vicky and sat her down right here and she would have stayed there, you know, and not gotten up and touched stuff and... You told her no, you know, don't do this or that. Always real affectionate, loved to hug, kiss, you know. She was sweet, just a sweet baby. When she started getting older, she was the same. Like I said, her room always stayed, and I always had a playroom for her. And we used to laugh because everything stayed in its place. She had little shelves, you know, and she'd go put her toys back on the shelves when she got finished playing. She was always just real neat. This used to be so funny. She had a red wagon, one of those pictures, she's sitting in it. It never went outside because she didn't want to get it dirty. You know, it stayed in the room. And Vicky's always been like that until she got to be a teenager. And then it all went, you know. I guess all girls go through that, you know, the clothes and throwing stuff under the bed, throwing it in the closet. Just before she moved, you know, I said, Vicky, you have got to get in that closet and clean it out. But, I don't know, she was always quiet. In high school, yeah, Vicky was basically the same way. She used to, you know, we had a good time when she was in high school because we had a camp at Falls River. And, we would go, I'd take a bunch of them over there skiing, you know, and I'd love to be around all of her and her friends. And we'd cut up and just have a good time, you know. She likes people. Vicky's like me. She likes to be around people. You know, she's a considerate person, I think, thoughtful. Just like now, she was my backbone the last year. She calls me every day, you know, see how I'm doing. And if I backslide, she'll tell me, now, Mom, you've come so far, you know, don't, you know, go backwards. Her and Brian both. Vicky always, I thought about this the other day when I was thinking about Brian about something. Vicky always dated boys that were quiet, like Brian. Let me tell you, I love Brian. Thank you.
even from when he first started going to camp. He went, excuse me, he went to Kehoe day 3 years old. So, of course, that was every summer. So that was swimming and all the different sports. He was a very good swimmer, and he liked sports. He was always involved in sports. He started off swimming, and then, of course, he was doing all the other things that they do at camp, the broad jumps and the certain amount of ball. And in school, he always played sports. Loved horse racing. Of course, he grew up with horse racing. At the OJD, when I was racing horses, he was too young. But at night, he and I used to go to the fence and watch our horses run through the fence. He was then like 3 years old, maybe 3.5 years old. And then the hurricane came in 65, and then we were just racing our horses at the fairgrounds and out of town. But there were many Saturdays when we went to the fairgrounds, and horses work in the mornings, and he rode the horse in the barn area under the shed row. My trainer was Alton Broussard, and he rode a horse called Blue, which Alton later gave to him as his riding horse. He kept it here at Jefferson Downs. But Brian loved horse racing. He really just cut his teeth on horse racing. When we went to construction here at Jefferson Downs, which was in 66, Brian had his horse. Back then, everything in the area was either pasture land or woods. So we had a gate across the bridge over on Duncan Canal, and we had a gate in the back, and his horse was named Blue, and his horse just had the whole run of the place. In fact, he used to walk up on the ramp and look inside the building, and if he'd get out, every now and then he'd get out, and we'd have to go find him way down in the back on along Sunset Boulevard, which was all woods then with just a little trail. We'd have to go get him and then bring him back. And so he must have had his horse for about maybe 3 years. And he always did like horses. Well, when we opened in 71, Brian would go up to the press box on Fridays and Saturdays. I'd let him go up on non-school nights. And of course, he loved the press box with all the carriages up there. And he'd come down every night with a roll of money in his pocket, and I'd ask him where he got the money. And he said, well, I had number three, and I had number five, and I had number five in the eighth race, number three in the second race. And so I'm thinking, well, tomorrow night he's going to lose it all, and then he'll learn. And the next night he'd come down with the same wad of money, and then I found out they were all staking him up there. And they explained it to me this way. Well, Brian dusts, he cleans up, and he answers the phone, and he does, so we have to pay him. So, of course, I had a long talk with everyone up there, and they cut that out. And then, of course, Brian started having some loses. But he used to, when I put him to bed at night, unbeknownst to me, on a school night, I thought that he was asleep. And what he was doing was he was climbing up his closet, getting in his closet and climbing up the shelves and going out through the ceiling, and go up to the press box, spend all night at the press box. Then at the time, Linda, who is now my secretary, was working on the switchboard, and she helped him. He'd come back and stick his head in the door and ask if the coast was clear, and if it was, she said, yeah, come on in. Then he'd run back in and go jump in bed. So here I was thinking that he's sleeping all this time, and I'd get notes from the teachers that he was sleeping during school, and that was a problem. They were sleeping all day in school, and of course, then that's how I discovered it. And that's when I shipped him off to boarding school. I lost Brian, if we talk about when we lose him, I lost him when he got his car. That's when I really lost it. Before that time, Brian and I did a lot of things together. We did everything together. And we did things as a mother and a child. When he got his car, he just kind of went his own way for about maybe 2 or 3 years. And then we got back together and started doing all the things we did, but we did all these things as adults then, as a mother and her son, but really as adults. He did a lot of things with me in campaigns and just grown-up things. And he and I have always been happy doing things with each other. Even maybe a year ago, I wouldn't have been ready for him to get married and to bring somebody else into our lives. But I've known Vicki now 4 years, and she's grown on me, and I'm really, really happy about it. I feel like they live right down the street. I see them every day, and even though we don't feel that we have to do things together all the time is just something that's just understood. And I feel very good about the marriage. And I think that we're going to really be close, and we're just going to, that it's going to continue. That the relationship Brian and I have had all these years is going to continue, and then we're going to have Vicki. And it's going to be three of us rather than two of us.
First time we met was in La Place at my father's house, and Vicki's little brother was returning from Colorado with my father and stepmother and little brother from skiing in Breckenridge. And we were dropping, my mother and I were dropping off some Christmas presents. I think it was a year later that the families got together, a group of people from Baton Rouge. My father was building a house in Baton Rouge, and Vicki's father was a builder. And some of their friends, mutual friends, had gotten together and took a trip, and I was invited, and I went. Naturally, a lot had been said by my stepmother about the possibilities of a relationship between Vicki and I. I wasn't really too keen about a situation like that because it was too arranged, and there were too many people that knew each other that were involved, and it just wasn't natural. It wasn't a natural thing. I kind of feel like maybe she had the same thoughts. Anyway, they stuck us on a plane together next to each other in the same two seats, and I don't think we said a word to each other for the whole trip going up there. And for the whole week while we were there, it was the week preceding New Year's. We didn't have too much to say to each other and kind of went our own ways. New Year's Eve, I didn't really feel like sitting home with the old folks. I wanted to go out and see what was going on in the town in Breckenridge. And Vicki wanted to also, so we decided to go together. And, so we went out. We had a really good time. We made about three or four different places, danced a little bit, and drank a lot. Really enjoyed each other's company. So the next day we left and we came back home. And after we returned, I called her and asked her out. That's just generally how things got started and how things got underway. It's been about 4 years, I guess, that we've known each other. And I guess it was about this past Christmas when we were in New York that I thought that we'd be really neat to be married to. Asking her to marry me there was no real dramatic build-up to it. It was just something that over a period of time we got to know each other and enjoyed each other's company. Very natural thing. I guess it wasn't on bended knee with ring in hand. It was just, well, I think we should do this. And she said, yeah, that's right. And, sort of as a formality, we went and ate at a nice restaurant in town, and I gave her ring. Even though it was a formal setting, it didn't have that drama involved that most people associate with engagement. Getting married. When we decided to be married, we had a choice either to do it as soon as possible in the year and or wait until the end of the racing season. You know, and normally I guess people take about 6 months to plan a wedding. Well, that would have fallen right at the end of the racing season. It would not have worked out well for either of us. Originally, we intended to do it in the first week of June, and we began talking about it in March. So it was going to be a quick thing, and then as the realities of the situation set in, we couldn't find a place. And the place that we wanted was booked when we did find it. And so it ended up being the last weekend in June. 4 months was it worked out well because we had time to do the planning that we needed to do and make the arrangements. I guess some of the things that really intrigued me about her from the start were her legs. She has extremely long, lithe legs, and I really enjoy those. And, second only to those is her accent. Always had a fetish for accents, but Vicky has a very noticeable southern accent, and I enjoy that immensely. And then other than that, just her whole attitude about life and what goes on around her. She's very lighthearted. She's very easy to be with. Vicky's not a vindictively jealous person. I don't feel as though I'm a vindictively jealous person. Jealousy is manifested in love is jealousy of attention. Anybody that loves each other, jealous of each other's attention, and they starve for each other's time, and you never seem to spend enough time with each other, especially in the situation that we've been in where she lived in Baton Rouge and I was either living here or in Hammond or across town in Baton Rouge. We never seem to have been able to spend enough time with each other, and it seems like marriage now, we may be able to solve the problem, we may get to see each other enough. You just have to, that remains to be seen. Love's a relative thing. It's, you know, it's what each person decides it to be. I think our dispositions are very much suited to each other. She's very level-minded in that she can deal with what I do and how I act. And I feel like I can deal with who she is and how she acts and what she does. I'm not always the easiest person to get along with, and sometimes has been cited as the hardest person to get along with. But she deals with that very well. She knows when to ignore me. She knows when to pay attention. She knows when to tell me to get off. I think the attraction between us is that we are very much suited to each other. We care for each other very deeply. And I think that's grown over a period of trials and tribulations, and it's worked itself into a very true love and a true feeling for each other. I think we'll be very happy together.
Right here. One, two. Where's my good smile you promised now?
There we are. Very good. Okay.
coming on this occasion in the presence of these friends to unite Brian and Vicki in marriage. The law defines marriage as a civil contract. It is a personal commitment by two people to each other. It is a personal commitment to love, honor, and cherish in good times and in bad, in sickness and in health. Brian, do you take Vicki to be your lawful wedded wife, to love, honor, and cherish in good times and in bad, in sickness and in health? Vicki, do you take Brian to be your lawful wedded husband, to love, honor, and cherish in good times and bad, in sickness and in health? Accept this ring as a symbol of the vows we have exchanged this day. Take the ring and put it on this finger. Please repeat after me. Please accept this ring as a symbol of the vows we have exchanged this day. Now that you have said the vows and exchanged the rings, I am authorized to pronounce you husband and wife. May your future together be one of happiness.
Jefferson Downs, we now have Mr. and Mrs. Brian Cranch.
We got the double. Are you
serious? You look so gorgeous.
Thank you. That was painless, wasn't it?
Brian, you look so calm.
You
the only one that was
trying to put the rings on and thing and doing like that.
Welcome you in the fans.
like a leaf up on the wind. I could find no place to land. I dream the hours away, wonder every day. Do dreams come true? Nobody loves me like you do.
Everybody right here at the camera for me. Just like that. One, two, three. Vicky, there we are. Stay right there now. Stay there, Grandma. Everybody right here. One more time for me. Grandma, Brian, Vicky, Grandpa. There we are. Oh, I said Grandpa and they all smiled. Look at that. Okay. I'm finished with y'all. Y'all go ahead back and relax. Y'all should just stay right there.
Y'all stay right there.
Okay. I would like Vicky's mom and dad. Stand up real straight for me, Vicky, up straight, just like that. One, two, Brian, smile, don't look at the call, stay right there. Right there, one, two, come up. There's a requirement, you gotta smile. Okay. And keep your hands still. He's got the movie camera, not me. There we go. One, two, three. One more. Brian, we gotta smile a little bit better than that. Right here for me. One, two, Miss Ezell, there we are. Thank you.
Happiness and lasting love. Not many people find it. Their whole life through, put their heart and soul behind it. A long and lasting love. A long and lasting love. It's what I always dreamed of. And when I looked, lasting love. I never thought that I would meet someone so beautiful. I never thought I'd see a love like this. Tonight I'll show you that our love is something beautiful. And I'll see lasting love. We share for many reasons a special bond that goes beyond the changing of the seasons. Long and lasting love. Long and lasting love. Someone I can care for. Someone to